We've been walking through this, the greatest story ever told, to quote an old movie from many years ago. It is absolutely the greatest story, and because we've heard it so often, we think we already know it, and we don't often contemplate the significance of all that has happened as Christ is walking towards Calvary. I trust you've been encouraged. That's been my desire. You'll have to let me know if it's been working, but I want you to be able to, this Easter season, to be ready to say to your friends and neighbors, listen, you need to come and hear about my Savior. The more I realize and the more I contemplate what he has done for me, and this should be the end result, the more I love him. The Bible is an amazing book written by so many over a span of nearly 1,500 years. And this is hundreds of years ago. Isaiah was the prophet, and God was telling him, these are the things that I want you to write about. Now, he did not understand everything that he wrote about because so many of those passages look to the future. They look to the future when Israel would be established on the earth as the kingdom, and David's descendant would sit on the throne. And of course, no one could fully understand everything, but there is a great passage, Isaiah 53, and I want you to consider whether or not Isaiah accurately paints the picture of what was to be. The story is about the Lord Jesus. And here's how Isaiah describes it. Just listen as I read. Who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? My servant grew up in the Lord's presence like a tender green shoot, like a root in dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. Yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be made whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own, yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet never said a word. He was like a lamb. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short in midstream. But he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. He had done no wrong and had never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. Yet when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have many descendants. He will enjoy a long life, and the Lord's good plan will prosper his hands. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. I will give him the honors of a victorious soldier because he exposed himself to death. He was counted among the rebels. He bore the sins of many and interceded for rebels. Notice in this passage, as Isaiah is writing about his people and their relationship with this Savior, this one who is coming, he doesn't call them misinformed. He doesn't call them ignorant. He calls them what they are, what we are, and that is we are rebellious. When we know that God's authority is up here, we look up and we say, no, I don't want it. I won't submit. It's not because we know better. It's not because somebody else has taught us a better way. No, it is our rebellion. But that great passage, and there's a verse in there that really highlights the theme of our message today. You see it on your paper, Isaiah 53:9. Listen to it. It's an odd verse. He had done no wrong and never deceived anyone. We believe that. We know our Lord Jesus. But he was buried like a criminal. Well, that is understandable. He was treated like a criminal, misjudged, persecuted. I mean, all of the circumstances were turning and twisting against him. But the truth is, he was buried like a criminal, but in a rich man's grave. How does that happen? Well, that's what we're talking about today. We'll get to that in a minute. But I think it's also important for us to understand what is so vital about what's happening in our story. Because he was buried, and because he was dead, he was buried. I mean, that's the key point in that. He was buried because he was dead, and then was raised on the third day. And here's what Paul said about it. Paul says, listen, now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you. And I've inserted Acts 20, 20, and 21, because it's really important that we understand how did Paul describe the gospel. Here's what he said. I never shrank back from telling you what you needed to hear, either publicly or in your homes. I have had one message for Jews and Greeks alike. And here it is. The necessity of repenting from sin and turning to God and having faith in our Lord Jesus. It's really important that we understand what the gospel is and that we respond to the gospel. Now, churches everywhere across time and now across this world will have ideas about how it's done and what it means and what you're to do. But the simple truth that Paul said after traveling all over the known world in Acts 20, he said, this is the same thing I've preached everywhere, and I've preached it no matter what the background of the group I was speaking to. Here it is. This is what you have to do. You have to realize that you are a sinner. And that's not enough just in itself. Oh, everybody admit, I'm not the man I ought to be. Well, I'm not claiming to be perfect, but so, I mean, that's not enough. Oh, I'm a sinner. Well, guess what? It's more than that. You are a sinner under condemnation. And now you need to turn to God because he's the one that holds the gavel. He's the one that's going to declare the destiny of your soul, whether it will be in that place of eternal judgment or whether or not it'll be in the place of eternal blessing. But even that is not enough. That is not enough to simply be a convicted sinner. And it's the Holy Spirit who does that work. People can hear the gospel again and again, different times of their lives. They might be stirred, but not changed. But there's a time when the gospel, when it's given, will be so riveting, it'll be so dynamic that you cannot get it out of your head or out of your heart. I mean, you are absolutely overwhelmed by its message. And its message is this. As a sinner, you have no hope. As a sinner, you are destined for judgment. But if you turn to God as a sinner and you place your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, then everything is changed. Now, some people will say, but I don't have very much faith. Way back in the early days when Beth and I were flying to Brazil. It was really the first time she had flown, and I want you to know that as a Baptist missionary, I was embarrassed to see my wife over there muttering every kind of religious phrase in the world because, I mean, she was scared to death. She says, I don't like this. I don't like this. And there's a funny thing that happens. Every time she says that when we're on the one time we were on a roller coaster doing something she doesn't like, it makes me laugh. And that's a wrong response. Let me just tell you that when she says, I don't like this, I don't like this, and I laugh, that's the wrong thing to do. But you know what? She got to Brazil just like I did. It did not matter if she had little faith or great faith. It was enough to get her from Chicago to Brazil. It does not matter. You might be thinking, but I don't know very much. You don't have to know very much. Well, I don't know if I have the right feelings. Well, you don't have to have any feelings. All you have to say is, wait a minute. I am a sinner condemned. And I stand before the all-knowing creator of the universe. And he says this, if you want salvation, believe in the work that my son did for you on Calvary. And it's amazing what those words can do. When we say in that privacy of our heart, God, I don't understand, but this I know. I am a sinner and I'm worried about judgment after I die. And if what Jesus did on the cross is enough for me, then I declare my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Have you done that? Now, some people will say, but those words, how can those words change your life? Well, some of you had a moment where you were, and maybe it's in the perfect place, you had planned for it, and you whispered just a few words, dear, I love you. Will you marry me? Not very many words, right? Did they change your life? Maybe you were the one that said, yes. Did just that one word change your life? It changed your life completely. That's what the Father is waiting to hear. The Father is waiting for us, the sinner, convicted by the Holy Spirit of God, convinced by the Holy Spirit of God, to step into the presence and fall to our knees and say, Father, I know I'm a sinner. I know I have no hope but what Jesus did on Calvary. And my faith, as meager as it is, as unimportant as it seems to be, I'm placing my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Savior for my soul. And those few words whispered in the quietness of your heart will change everything. Have you said those words to your Father? Have you whispered those words of faith? Well, we go on. He says, now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you've taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved if you firmly hold firmly to the word I preach to you. Otherwise, you believed in vain. For what I received I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Let me read that again. I goofed it up. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And if Christ had not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. But as Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, and then the story goes on, your life is changed for all eternity. Paul, in talking about the gospel, said, listen, I want you to know that not only did he die on Calvary, the evidence keeps stacking up that he was buried according to the scriptures. He was buried as a criminal, but somehow was in a rich man's grave. How did that happen? Well, let's take a look at it. Well, to understand the burial, though, we need to know that the bodies of the criminals were treated differently. Now, the Romans had the practice of allowing the corpse to rot on the cross or throwing them into a dung heap. That's the heap nobody wants to go to. That's the heap you move with your uniloader, all right? I mean, that's how they treated the criminal. They would leave him on the cross, and everybody going in and out of Jerusalem would go by and see, and they would be reminded, this is what Rome does to her enemies. Not only are they crucified, they are disrespected and humiliated. We know that this burial or this death was a bit different because it was happening right before the Passover. And right before the Passover, the Jews went to the Romans and said, listen, this is our holiest of days. Do this for us. And you know how the give and take would happen in a regime like the Roman Empire. They would give if they got something in return. And they said, okay, we'll make sure nobody's on a cross during your holy days. But remember, you owe us. So Jesus, taken down from the cross to be buried, it would seem if the Romans were in charge, he would just be hauled out of the city limits and thrown into a pile with the garbage. Now, the Jews had a different understanding. The Jews' practice was to bury the executed in a designated place of shame. They could not be buried with good people. There was a special place that nobody wanted to be associated with, and that's where everybody would go if they had been executed in one form or the other. But what about Jesus? His was a different story. Let's look at the burial of Christ. As evening approached, Matthew tells us, Joseph, now another writer tells us that Nicodemus, you remember Nicodemus, was also with him, but Joseph, a rich man from Arimathea, had become a follower of Jesus. This Joseph went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. And Pilate issued an order to release it to him. Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a long sheet of clean linen cloth. He placed it in his own tomb, which had been carved out of the rock. Then he rolled a great stone across the entrance and left. Both Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting across from the tomb and watching. The next day, on the Sabbath, the leading priests and Pharisees went to see Pilate. They told him, Sir, we remember what this deceiver once said while he was still alive. After 3 days, I will rise from the dead. So we request that you seal the tomb until the third day. This will prevent his disciples from coming and stealing his body and then telling everyone that he was raised from the dead. If that happens, we'll be worse off than we were at first. Pilate answered, take guards and secure it the best you can. So they sealed the tomb and posted guards to protect it. Isn't it interesting that Joseph, going to Pilate, a man of connections, otherwise he would not have gotten an audience. He was a part of the Sanhedrin, the very group that betrayed Jesus. And he goes to Pilate and he says, Pilate, could I have the body? Now, this is a big deal for Joseph and Nicodemus. This is right before the Passover. In touching the body of Jesus, they have disqualified themselves for any of the religious ceremonies. That's why Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting away from the burial. You know, that's the job they would have done. And can't you see Joseph and Nicodemus saying, no, there's no reason for you to be defiled. No reason for you to be left out of the celebration of the Passover. You need it now more than ever because look at what's happened to us and our world. So there these two rich men are doing the work of slaves, trimming the hair, trimming the nails, washing the body. And if there was ever any chance that he was not dead, those two men would have found it. It was the habit to stretch the body across the stone and then with warm water go through a purification ceremony, and they would wash away the dirt and the grime, and in this case, the blood and the torn tissue. They would wash his back. They would turn him over and wash the thorn-punctured brow. They would have cleaned out the places where the nails went in. And doing all of this, if Jesus had been alive, he would have gasped. He would have said a word. He would have moaned or groaned. The point of the scripture is this: your Savior died. Don't be mistaken. Don't be confused by what liars and deceivers will tell you. Your Savior, the perfect Son of God, went to Calvary and he died for you. And not only that, he was buried according to the scriptures. A criminal buried in a rich man's tomb. And there that heavy stone was not only guarded but sealed. Wax or clay put around it so that if it moved even an eighth of an inch, it would have cracked or torn away the seal. I mean, these people who are against Jesus heard better his prophecy than his followers who have scattered during this day. They remembered well. He said he would be raised on the third day. He said that he gives his body to death and he takes his body from death. We're going to make sure it doesn't happen. He is going to be buried and he's absolutely dead and it's not going to be heard of again. It's settled for all of history. This is a fool who died for no reason. That was their plan. Look at the assurance. Isn't this a great passage that the writer of Hebrew gives to us? I've put two chapters together, two parts, chapter 2 and chapter 4, but I think when we read them, they read beautifully. It explains why Jesus was born of a virgin. It explains why Jesus lived in our filthy world and lived a perfect life. It explains why he did all the things he did. It explains why he came to seek and to save the lost, why he went to Calvary, why he went to the grave, and why he was raised on the third day is now awaiting his return. But notice the words. The writer says this: because God's children are human beings made of flesh and blood, the Son also became flesh and blood. For only as a human being could he die, and only by dying could he break the power of the devil who had the power of death. Only in this way could he set free all who have lived their lives as slaves to the fear of dying. We also know that the Son did not come to help angels. He came to help the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, it was necessary for him to be made in every respect like us, his brothers and sisters, so that he could be our merciful and faithful high priest before God. Then he could offer a sacrifice that would take away the sins of the people. Since he himself has gone through suffering and testing, he is able to help us when we are being tested. So then, since we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weakness, for he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. I've invited the praise team to come and lead us in a closing song. If they'll come up and make their themselves ready. But let me just share with you. I know we've stopped the story before the best part. You know, when you read to your kids and you read them the story and you stop before the last page or the last chapter and they say, read it, read it, read it. And to increase the enjoyment of the story, you say, no, 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 we'll finish it tomorrow night. I know that we're stopping at an awkward place in this great story. Our Savior, mistreated, misjudged, abused, tortured is the word, dying on a cross and now in a cold tomb is a terrible place to stop the story. But let me tell you that another Sunday is coming. That there is a great story to be told when he comes up out of that grave. Because we don't want to leave here with that sad note. We want to celebrate the fact that this Savior is alive and his death and his burial and his resurrection has the potential to change every single life. While we sing this song, I'm going to ask you to sing with us. I'm going to ask you to consider what's happening right here. Where are you in this process? Has the Holy Spirit of God convicted you of your sin? Are you desperate? Are you thinking, what's going to happen? I don't even like to think about my own death. I don't know where I'm going to go. I don't know what's going to happen to me. Let me tell you this, that if you turn to God as a sinner and you place your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, those few words whispered in the quietness of your heart will change everything, including your destiny. Because like our chorus will tell us, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. But the story goes on. Would you sing with us? Stand up, if you would, and join our praise team.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example as he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us. Glory revealed. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day. Over death he sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day. One day sins far away, rising he justified, freely forever, one day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day, oh glorious day.
Let's pray together. Father, we know that we don't fully comprehend all that was involved in this great story. That's what we do when we come and we sing and we contemplate and meditate. But Lord, we know that we'll marvel at it for all eternity, that this was what you were willing to do to reach us. Father, it may be that we have some here who have considered it all in all for many, many, perhaps years, and yet they've never come to the place where they are ready to say, Jesus, I know that you died for me, and I'm trusting you to be the Savior of my soul. Lord, I'm asking that this is their day, that this will be the day of their salvation. Father, for the rest of us who say we know him, and yet we've been denying him with our words, we've been denying him with our life's objectives and goals. We've been thinking that this life is for us to live the way we want, and we've forgotten that we have been called to serve our Savior. Lord, I'm asking that each person here would make sure that that good decision is made, to love him, to put faith every bit in him, to follow him, to serve him, to obey him. Lord, we know that this will honor him. Father, we know we get to come into your presence and speak to you in this frank way because of what Jesus did on Calvary. And that's why we say we ask for this in Jesus' name, in the name of our Savior. Amen.